worried about risk, they want to avoid making a decision. So when you're giving them a small sample, you're checking them out, they're checking you out. If they take a small sample and can't sell it, you don't want giving them a big sample because they're going to be complaining customers. If they take a small sample and they go out there and do it, and it works, then you can go back and say that worked. Are you open to doing more? But that way, you're testing your customers to see are they time customers you want, and if they're not, just don't deal with them. Is that how much someone?
Absolutely.
Great, fabulous. Other questions? Yes, in the back there. Smart young man with the Cody.
I used to have one.
Yes.
I tried it in the past, but it's not, it didn't work for me.
Okay, because customers say that sometimes, even though they do push-ups. So, that's
they
right.
I didn't say it.
No, that's right, you stopped saying it, you said the word. But let me ask you this, we'll address that for later on, okay? So right now, let's address this question. I'm sorry you didn't hear it, you didn't use it in the past. May I ask you what experience you have? That is the question, but you don't have enough information to address that question directly. You need more information about their experience to find what they had versus what you drew. They may have used, you do the sound awakening stuff.
No,
is that correct?
I'm actually addressing advertising right now.
Okay, so whatever you're addressing, it works the same for everyone. You need to find what they did, what you do, find the distinction that is different, and you sell them on the difference into your product. Some guys, well, I've done that before and it didn't work. I don't understand that. Tell me exactly your experience. Oh, I see. So you marketed here with this background, this demographic. We're not doing that. We're going in this direction, totally different results. So you're selling on what you're doing, not what a competitor's experience was. Now, if they said, we bought from you before and it didn't work, you've got an issue. Which that means you didn't deliver. So at that point there, you're going to find out what happened that you bought from us and you didn't get the results you were after. What was missing? Why did you feel that it didn't give you what you were after? What was missing from us that if we delivered, you would have got the result? And then maybe you offer them a free sample to show them that you're back on track again delivering what they wanted. And you turn a customer around who's a no, then you do a yes, but you take away that first fear step about doing it again and making a mistake, and once you get the results, then you keep selling them all. But they're not going to go and buy a big package if they've used it before and you haven't delivered. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yes, who else? Come on, I'm on a roll here. Yes, young man.
I led this back to my husband.
Oh, that's a great one. First thing is you need to acknowledge them for having someone that you need to speak to. Now, I really acknowledge you for needing to speak to your husband. Speak to your spouse before you make a decision. That tells me that person really important to you. So I really acknowledge that. Let me ask you this. If they said yes, would you be going ahead with this product? Okay, would they?
Yeah.
If they said yes, would you be going ahead with the product?
They'd have to say yes.
Well, how about we do this? We've done all the paperwork to lock everything in place so you get the special offer we're offering to you now. So you need to have some special offer available that they're taking advantage of right now. Let's lock in that special offer so you get that bonus, that something you're going to get as part of this offer. And then we put in the bottom there, subject to the right to cancel within 72 hours. That way you go back to your spouse, say, this is what I'm going to be doing. And they say no, you come back to us, we simply rip the contract up and there's no further obligation. That way you're locked in the bonus, because if you come back later and say I want to do it, you're not going to get A, B and C as part of that package. So you need to find something as an incentive to get them to write down the contract right now, but they have an out clause if it doesn't work for them. So you need to have that out clause subject to right, it never do we put down there approval of the partner. Because now, if they don't come back to you, the contract is void. You want to make sure that if they don't come back to you, the contract goes live. Very, very important. So it's a right to cancel, and the whole idea with subject to contracts is you want to have as few subject to clauses possible. And your goal is to eliminate them as fast as possible. So say it says, subject to the spouse agreeing. Or you say, subject to a right to cancel within 72 hours. Now, 72 hours elapses, that clause is gone, the contract's valid. Does that answer your question? Yes, what else?
For where I come from, almost all women make the buying decisions.
Yes.
That's them. If a woman says to me, I've got to speak to my husband, she's really saying no. And
then you need to go back to value, but you haven't sold the value. If she's using the husband as a fall off, go away, you haven't sold on the value of why she really wants it. So you need to get a point of commitment. Do you want this? If the husband was not an issue, would you buy this? Well, I really need to speak to him. That's you're not interested. Would you, if the husband was not, you had no input, would you buy it? Yes. Great, that's when you're going to use them. But you need to get commitment before you go to subject to. Just one moment, over here. Yes.
Okay, this is an actual example that's happening at the moment.
Yes.
So this particular man, he ready to sign up with me. He's a stay-at-home dad. His mum is the breadwinner, financial controller. And he said, I really want to do this. I just got to get her sign off. I've got nothing to do with the finances. And she actually said no. He does want to do it because he keeps contacting me. I'm not following him up. But she said no.
Great, no problem. Easy to handle. First of all, write that down. That's easy. But if you say, you know what, that's a tough one. Energetically, they're going to get it. You know what, actually, that's very easy to handle. She has no idea what he's doing. So she's not going to verify or approve what someone else is doing without any understanding.
Bring her in.
So either A, you bring her in some way so she understands, or B, you work with him at a discount rate or a free sample so she can go back and demonstrate results to her. Well, he goes, okay, whatever you're doing, you need to do more of that. So she needs to see positive results to endorse the payment to go through, or she needs to become part of the process to see the results. That might be harder, because if she's already working full-time as a breadwinner, she's probably like, I'm not going to do that. But if you can get him and do some small work, now it's going to cost you some money. You're going to be at risk in a little bit. How much is the deal worth?
$2,500 or $2,750.
So could you do a small amount of work and maybe even have a conference call with all of them? So it's not a meeting.
The issue with that is that this is what I specialise in, which is chronic depression, and it really is the third session where we start unpacking all the stuff before we actually see the positive change. So small amount of work, I mean, that's three sessions into
it. Sure, I understand. Just so it's okay.
Yeah.
So in that case, you need, before you suddenly go, when you have to go and deal with all that, you need her buy-in. So in that case, it might just simply be, you organise a call directly with her and say, here's the cost for you not having your husband go through this. Or you ask the other side first, how would you like your husband relationship with your husband to be? Because clearly, if he's depressed, it's a crappy relationship. How would you like, in the ideal scenario, how would you like the relationship with the husband to be? How is he showing up now where he's not quite where you like him, i.e. like down here? She needs to have a big gap, very clearly, from what's possible to what's happening. And go, imagine he stayed like that for the rest of your life.
How soon would you get a divorce?
How much would that cost you emotionally, energetically, in the relationship? Do they have kids?
Yes. He looks after all of them.
How much is that going to affect your family dynamics for the next 10 years? And what if it ended up, for a small amount of money, equivalent per year, you had your husband back the way you were when you married him? Is that worth having? And then maybe it's like, you know what, I know you can't see that right now, but let me show you, how many sessions you do with him?
How many sessions?
How many sessions are you going to do with him?
Well, it's depression then weight loss, so it's 13.
13 sessions?
Yeah.
So you say to her, because I understand you're skeptical right now, and if I was in your shoes, I'd be skeptical too. You're letting her know she's okay. It's normal to feel how she feels. How about we do this? We start doing a payment plan for 4 sessions. So there's no way you're not paying for all 13 up front. You're taking a risk. Let's do pay for 4 sessions, and we'll do a review on a regular basis so you can see the results. You can give me feedback how he's showing at home, and you'll make sure you're getting value for money from what I'm providing. You need her buy-in. Now that might mean you're getting 2.5 up front, you're getting payment plans, but at a certain point, if you get results and you're good at what you do, are you good at what you do?
I'm the best.
You're the best at what you do. Then you'll get the results over those 4 sessions.
Absolutely.
She'll see shifts in him, and she'll be like, whatever you're doing, do more of it.
Yeah.
But you need her buy-in through that conversation.
Okay.
Does that answer your question? Great. Yes, to the back.
Email that says, thank you very much for your time, but due to my financial restraint and situation beyond my control, I will not be able to start the journey.
They're broke. Move on.
Okay.
There's a big world out there with lots of people who have lots of money. If someone says, like, you know what, I'm in a little bit of tight financial situation, they're broke. That's not likely to change very much. So you really got to spend more time with them and dig deeper. Into why? Do you have a personal relationship? Do you know this person?
Well, after 4 sessions, I know them very well. 3 sessions, mind you.
Okay, so 3 free sessions?
Yeah.
And what are you getting them to commit to?
It was only 3 months of weekly sessions. Basically.
And how much?
$1,800.
So in the 3 sessions right now, what do you think? What's missing from them? Can they see the value in what you've done already? The 3 sessions so far.
Read the bottom part.
I'm very, very grateful that I have met you, Marjana, and I wish you all the best in your career. You are passionate about everything that you do. You are amazing. You have talent, a great soul, because you give from your heart.
Great. And also, you need to be paid for it.
Yeah.
Okay. So you need to be paid for it. But you can't keep giving like that forever without receiving anything back.
But I seem to be attracting the people who love me. But
are you ready? Stop it.
Yeah.
That was easy. Okay. So now you've stopped it and moved on. You need to find better quality clients who have the money to pay for it. It's a great saying that says, if you open a restaurant, you should open a restaurant where there are hungry customers who have money.
Private schools, and she goes on holidays, and she's like,
okay, that's different.
You gave her too much
free stuff. Okay, that's different. If she's got 2 kids in private school during the holidays, she's got money coming in.
So it's an excuse.
She may have a lot of money coming in, and obviously a lot of money going out. So what is happening is they haven't seen the value of the sessions. If they've got money coming in, even though the money might be coming out and it's tight, they will be able to find a way to pay you if you provide the value and they can see it over time. 3 free sessions, people don't normally value 3 very much. So you need to paint the picture of where they are going on the current trajectory and where they're going. It's a bit like this. Change that mentality right away. And it's not, you know what they're saying, like, give away free sessions. Listen to me. You don't give away free sessions. You give away introductory sessions so people understand how you work to evaluate whether they want to do more work with you. Free has no value. But introductory sessions offered at no price, no cost, so they can evaluate, are you all right fit to go forward? So this is when he met Najla. This is the result you've been getting so far. He's happy and amazed, but not ready to spend money. When he's selling on is keep working for 3 months, this is the benefit you get.
Excellent.
So the amount of money is going to benefit you in everything, in stress and everything else, is huge compared to how much it's going to cost. Right now they can't see that. So you need to expand on the long-term value of what you're doing over time. That's the trajectory here, and that's why they do it. When the value is there, they'll find the money. Otherwise, one over here, yes. You were pointing to her earlier, like, yes.
Oh no, Colonel, do you believe everyone is closable? Or what?
No, not at all. What? You don't want to close some people. You do not want to be closing everybody. You close everybody, you're going to have a whole pile of problems for some people. And the ones that you go really hard to close, to take a lot of time and effort to close, they're the ones who cause you the most problems. In fact, it's better to turn people away. You know, I'm sorry, you're not eligible for my program. What? I'm sorry, you're not ready to do it. I'm not sorry, you're not ready to be buying and stocking our products. And so maybe when you meet this criteria, bom, 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 come back to us, we'll see if we're a right fit at that point. And what's their thought? Well, I want your product. So it's called the takeaway close. What you take away, people want even more. So you sell them normally, and they're like, arming and arming. You know what? You're right. Thank you so much for the clear. Clearly, this is not right for you right now. So let me pack everything up here. No. What do you mean? If people are wavering, you need to get them to commit one way or the other. Make a decision, yes or no. And they're like, well, you know what? This product's not for you. You pack up, you gotta walk away. Either they won't follow you, good. Or they will follow you and go, okay, well, let's do it. And then you make the terms. Well, if you're gonna join us, here's the terms it's gonna take for you to join us. You're gonna need to take this product and this product. There's no refunds, there's no this, and you lay out the terms when they're chasing you. Yes, other ones. Yes, right over here.
This is our first quote, so we can't possibly make a decision right now.
Ooh.
Fabulous. Fabulous. Great. How many quotes are you anticipating getting?
Three.
Usually two or three.
Great. Two or three quotes. First of all, I acknowledge you for doing your due diligence. I acknowledge them. That way they go, oh, okay. But that's good. They should be doing getting multiple quotes. If they get one quote and buy it, they're not doing enough due diligence, which means they're not a client who's making good financial decisions. Do you want clients who make good financial decisions?
Absolutely.
So when they buy your product, they, you know what? I did all the research. He was the best one on the marketplace, and I bought him and he delivered. Isn't that what you want to hear?
Yes.
Not like, you know what? I bought a fence, but I think I overpaid for it. So you want people to do that, do the three. So how many quotes are you looking at getting out? Well, actually, I'm looking at getting three quotes. Fabulous. On what criteria are you going to judge buying the whichever one you do? Well, price. So you're only shopping on price, is that correct? Well, yeah. So does that tell me if someone comes in undercuts, doesn't promise to deliver all the work, or they promise it, but they're not going to deliver all the work, they don't have the research, they don't have the experience we do, you're going to go with a cheaper option just because it's cheaper? No. So what criteria? Because in my experience, here's what astute buyers do. Are you filming this?
Not yet.
Here's what astute buyers do. They're going to select the best fence on these six criteria. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Funny enough, you meet all six. And it's going to be on experience, relationship with the local councils, building quality, and then you go, well, let me show you how we fit into it. Here's all our criteria, here's all our testimonials, here's what John said at local council when we submitted this fence, and you have a booklet, obviously you do, showing all the fences you've done, and pointing out how you meet those six criteria. Then you say, you know what, please go get the other two quotes, we'll come back to you in a week, when you've got the other quotes, and we can discuss it all, and when you're ready to go ahead with us, we'll start work. You're telling them to get the other quotes, because the other quotes should not match up to your six criteria. At that point there, you're the best decision, they'll come back and go, you know what? I spoke to this person, they came in cheaper, but they didn't have number three. You go, you know what? Number three is missing a lot out there in the marketplace. And probably number six they were missing too. They didn't even mention number six. Well, you know what? That's why we're the one you should go ahead with. So we may be 15% more, but let me tell you this. I've had clients who come in the same seat as you, and they've gone and got planning to get a fence from us, and they decided to save $2,000 for the fence. They paid the other contractor, the other contractor got three quarters of the way, and got called away on a more lucrative deal. The fence was three quarters complete, and done badly. So they then had to hire another person to do the fence, then tore it all down, rebuild it, and ended up costing them close to double. So in the long run, it's far cheaper to get it done right, first time, 100%, because sometimes the little money you save in the beginning ends up being big money you pay later on to correct their mistakes. Does that make sense?
Very good.
Okay, yes, over here.
Well, I just want to actually say one thing real quick, because I had an experience where I was closing someone, and they actually tried to get a better deal and all this stuff, and kept trying to get at me, and I pretty much said, well, maybe we're just not the right mark, you know, the right mark of something. And I tried to, you know, say
that's right. You're on a roll right now. You're at 60, shut up. You should come to the shower and table.
And he ended up coming back at me like, no, I am really interested in all this stuff. And he's going to order a big amount of advertising.
Fabulous. So you want to do the 60 put-ups in one go, or two sets of 30? Which one works better? Okay, we'll start over here, young man. Okay, see, that's it, closing, right? Look at that. I'll be going through two sets of 30. Yes, over here.
Okay, I've got a situation at the moment. So I'm actually, I've got a hypnotherapist working for me in my clinic. So I do the free consults, which I sell my programs to, and I'm trying to sell them.
Pause, listen to what you just said.
Okay, I'll do 20 push-ups.
Yeah, you're going.
So I'm selling them for her, not for me. That's what I want, because yes. I want to free up my time. But they keep saying to me, well, you're the one sitting in front of me right now. She's cheaper, so I've put her at a cheaper price point.
Yes.
You're the one sitting. I feel comfortable with you. It's you I want. So I'm finding.
Yes, you know what? You can certainly do that. Although you do understand how standard rates are X of all our hypnotherapists. But you can get mine. And as the manager of the company, I do charge a premium price. So if you prefer to have me, I'm more than willing to do that. Or if you want to get the same result or very similar result with one of our team members, then totally go with whoever name is Sally. And here's why Sally's been amazing. And let me tell you a quick story about a client who shared with Sally, and you share the story, and then you know what? Sally sounds pretty good. You know what? You're gonna fall in love with Sally. She's amazing, she's got great experience. That's why I brought her on. She's the same mindset, same skill set as me, and she's proved to be worth every single dollar since she came on. You're edifying her, so they're not looking at you, they're looking at her. And if they decide, you know what, Sally's not for me, I want you, then you go, yo, you're paying 50% more than Sally. To the point you price them out of the market, and you have the team taking all the work. Yes?
I don't have room to stock your products.
I understand that. I've heard many people say that. Let me share you a quick story. This is where you need to have lots of good stories of you working with clients. So, Nancy, is it?
Yeah.
Nancy, let me tell you a quick story. I had a client who came in exactly like you. They had a packed store, they had no room, and they saw what we did, but they thought it'd be great, but where are they going to put it? So what we said was this. Can you find a small area to do a sample, to do a test of what we've got? And when we come in there and assume you're one of our biggest clients and treat you exactly the same and do the same support for your client as you would for any other client. And in your store, I mean, assuming you're selling quite a lot from your store, aren't you? As you gradually make room on your shelves, if you had a high profit, popular, successful product that was unique to your suburb, do you think you'd find more room on your shelves in the future? Great. So what we'll do, get you started with a small amount. As you free up other products and you free up shelf space, we can work with you and gradually expanding your product range to meet exactly what you want to get those profit products on your shelf. So it's not about now, how much you get now. We want to see you as a long-term client, and we're going to work with you to build up the product range as space becomes available. Would that work for you? Of course it would. Okay, next. Yes.
Given that there's no value in free, something being free, so I don't charge a fee for my service.
Are you allowed to legally?
Yes.
You are? Okay. There's different countries and different financial advisors have different things about how much they can charge. Okay.
So at the moment, I don't charge a fee. Let's say for the next 6 months, for instance, I continue on with that. Should I lose that wording from any sort of advertising I do, free service?
I would not advertise the fact it's a free service. And that you are currently offering a reduced rate to new people to evaluate what you're doing. And later on, as they become ongoing clients, then you can reinstitute that as you're going after they've got results. But to go free, people are going to start taking more and more free stuff off you. See, here's why Frontier Trainings works in play to win. Clinton offers a 3-day introduction program worth $1,295 at no charge. People come in, they do 3 days of play to win. At the end of 3 days of play to win, they've had such a transformational experience, he can go and sell a lifetime membership because they can see the value. If Clinton did play to win as a 2-day event, he wouldn't establish the same value. Play to win as a 1-day event wouldn't work. Play to win as an evening seminar would be a disaster. Because you're not going to upsell from a no-charge event up to a $30,000 package in a 3-hour evening event. There's no experience of it. So they need to experience you. Once they see the results, they need to put your thing back. But let them experience, you know, 3 months introduction at no charge. But clearly established, you can charge for this service, and later on you will charge for this service when they're seeing results. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So just quickly on.
Yes.
Would you then not use any free synonyms like no cost?
No, you could use them, but avoid the word free.
Yep.
And put it like at no charge, at no cost. Because if people hear at no cost, and they can see that you normally charge for it, that's a different mindset. But just free. A very different mindset.
Yep.
What else? Yes.
What if the objection comes from you? One of my colleagues said to me, sure, don't say no before the customer does. And one of the things that I'm struggling with here is that I get that you want to show the value, but if somebody says no to me, I feel really awkward to handle the objections because I feel in a sense like I'm pushing them into something or I'm begging them for something. So there's a whole lot of spaghetti going
on. Yeah, get over it. Strip that crap out of there. Have you got something of value?
Yes.
Do you make a difference in people's businesses?
Yes.
Are you providing the value that can transform their business?
Yes.
Then get out of your own head and go and sell it to them. TRB can put it this way. If you have this product that will make a difference to other people, you have an obligation to sell it. Which means you need to get out of your own crap and stand strong to support your product if you've got something to make a difference. If you're going to make a difference, when they say no, your job is not to shy away or shirk away from them. Your job is to find out why it's a no, dig deeper, and find out genuinely, could they use your service? And if they could, how do they get it? And all that spaghetti crappy stuff, you need to get past that as soon as possible, and you will hear Frontier Trainings. To get past that, to be confident in what you're selling, and be able to go there and close big deals. No problem. Who else? Come on, yes.
What if you have, what if I'm dealing with the advertising, what if they say, I've already spent my money on other advertising?
You mean this one? I've got no money in my budget.
Yes.
You mean that question?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I've spent my budget for this year.
Yep, that's a good one.
That equivalent of what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, congratulations for having a budget. What does that mean? It means to allocate money specifically for the area that you specialize in. That's a good decision on their part. all it means is they can't do it this year. So the first thing I say to them is this. So when's your next BRM?
I don't know what RM is.
Oh, sorry. So BRM stands for Budget Review Meeting. And what you find in most organizations who are successful, listen to the words, most organizations who are successful, they have a regular BRM, budgetary review meeting, to make sure their budget is being used effectively for the year. Some people do it every 4 months, some every 3 months, some every month, reviewing their budget to make sure their budget is spent to get maximum results for the company. So you don't have a budget review meeting planned? So is there any possibility you could meet with the other key people and first of all, is this product right for you? Is the product I'm sharing with you, do you feel it's right for you if you had the money right now?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you had the money right now, you'd go ahead if money wasn't the issue.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so any possibility you get all the key people involved in your budget together, sit down, and I'll discuss with them the financial benefit of doing what you're saying. And then we can plan, maybe it'd be better in 2 months' time or 3 months' time to implement this part of your budget, and maybe you'll find some wiggle room in the budget to be able to adjust it to include this. And if for some reason there's no room to include that in your budget this year, how about we discuss to plan it to be included in next year's budget already, so as soon as next year's budget comes around, it's already factored into what you want, and we go straight into production at that point there. But ideally, we go to a BRM meeting with your key people and we'll see if there's any room to free up your budget right now. Would you be open to that? Because if you want the product, but you're like, my boss won't let me, you're not the decision maker. We need to go back to the decision maker. Because if you were the decision maker, you'd find room in your budget for it. But you can't because you're a victim to your budget. Great, let's speak to people who make the budget. Change around and get it. The fact is, they've got a budget for things like this. All they need to do is show the value of the company, and that most companies will find room in their budget for things that are going to help to build their business. Yes?
How would you then transition to get to the speak to the decision maker rather than that person?
Great, so I know you're really busy right now. Can we possibly have a meeting for coffee? Could we have a phone call? And let me have a quick conversation for 2 to 3 minutes about what this product is and see if we can take it forward. And if not, go, you know what, well, how about we plan it? Can you submit it for next year's budget? Next one, over here, yes. Your question is not a question, yes.
What if they say, I don't want to use my credit card online?
So how do you prefer to pay? Do you prefer to pay by wire?
Change it.
Get it to change it.
Well, let me say this. The company normally prefers credit card, but if I spoke to the company, I'm sure they would accept other methodologies of payment. So you simply when you have received payment, they want the product. So you need to find a way to be more flexible if they can't receive credit cards online. There are websites where they can actually put the credit card in without it being disclosed to anybody. So there's other services online that can solve what you're after without them having to give up their credit card number and putting it online. That's an easy one to solve. That's simply how to transfer money. Yes?
Another option is they can buy a prepaid $500 or $300 credit card at COL or something.
That's still too hard for them, I reckon. You've got to do PayPal. You've just got to make it easy.
You have to make payments easier. Look, there used to be an insurance company that used to take 20 days to get a policy approved by them. And took 20 people had to pass through for approval. They finally went through, ripped it all apart, rechanged it all. The policy book now gets approved in 3 hours, and it takes 2 people to approve it. You want to make buying easy. You want to make buying hard, like, well, here's our 18-step payment process. Okay, what else we got there? A couple more.
Here.
Yes, over there, yes.
I just don't have the time at the moment to come on a monthly basis.
So how important is it to you to be able to grow your business? Is it?
Very important.
Very important right
but
now.
I need to see customers, not come to another meeting or...
So if you met one person who opened up 50 customers, would that be valuable to?
Sure,
would 200 be. Customers, would that be valuable to?
Yes, it would.
So networking is a way where rather than going one person at a time, you may be able to get access to a huge number of people through the people we have at our networking event. So while the people at networking may not directly be your customers, many of them are already successful people with a lot of customers who they can help support you in what you're doing. So even though it seems to be a lot of work to come for one morning, once a month, if you could go and bring in 10, 20, 30, 50 customers each time you come, would that help grow your business?
Yes, it would.
So in reality, the most important thing is growing your business, and you need to come. And while it may seem like a lot of your time for 4 hours to come to a networking event, the networking and the relationships you build could serve your company for years.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, over here, yes.
The objection is, it just doesn't feel right to give up 20% of my company to a relative stranger that I only just met recently.
I understand. This is where you go and tell a story. You know what? I was speaking to Peter earlier, and Peter was in exactly the same shoes as you. In fact, he was being asked for 30% of his company. And he was like, why should I give 30% of you? I've been working on this for years. And so here's what Peter did. Peter was reluctant to give it, but went ahead anyway. Well, we went through, we implemented everything we said we were going to do. We told the results he was after, and when he ended up banking his first $1 million, he said he apologized for doubting what we provided. You see, we've been doing this now for 12 years, 10 years, 2 years, whatever it is, and we've got proven track record results with companies, and as a result of that, those that work with us, who we choose to work with, get the results. Does that mean you know who we are yet? No. But as long as you know someone's got a track record of proven results, that's what really matters, and that's what we have. And if you want to speak and want to check out track record, is this, are there any more questions? When do you want to start?
So you're asking them to take a leap of faith that are justified from it.
Justified. Totally justified. Take away that fear. And again, you give them a guarantee. You know what? If we haven't got the results within a year, we're going to pull back, we're going to give you your shares back, because frankly, we're not the right people for you. Yes, back there.
Colonel, I know that I need some help, but I've only just started looking and I don't know who else is out there on the market that can help me.
Now, that's a great question. There's lots of people out there. There's lots of people out there with very little experience. There's lots of people out there who don't know what they're doing. There's lots of people out there that really don't want to be in their businesses. There's a lot of people out there you haven't met yet. So the key here is, you're lucky you found someone with a track record who delivers. So you can definitely go out there and spend a lot more time hunting for that needle in a haystack to find the right fit for your business. We've sat down there, we've talked about your business, I understand your business, I know we can deliver. Here we go, this is what Joanna said when we helped her business. A story. Testimonials, endorsements, credibility, you're backing up your track record and say, look, the question is, would you like to move your business forward faster right now?
Absolutely.
So you can either spend 2, 3, 6 months or a year hunting for someone else who may be able to do it for 10, 15, 20% cheaper, although they may not deliver the same result, or you can get started right now with a proven track record and start making the results you want now.
Excellent.
So let's get to work. Yeah. Yes?
It's been really quiet. I don't need to be ordering
anymore. So when's your busy period? In other words, it's quiet. You've got to find out, why is it quiet? Are they simply not selling because you're about to go out of business? Well, there's a clue. You don't want to sell them and have your name go in their store and get discount off. So why is it a slow period? Is it off season? If it's off season, then you say, great, let's plan for when you're moving some shelf space, and let's plan in a 4 month time, just before your busy period, let's get the stock in there so you move it right away. But you don't want to go, you know what, everything's slow, let's get our product in your shelf and let's gather dust for the next 6 months while you're not selling anything. You don't want that, they don't want that. So find out where the next busy period is, and make sure you get in just as they're starting that busy period where you get swept up with their results. But if they go, you know what, our busy period, we haven't been busy for 4 years. You go, you know what, I understand that. It's challenging out there, isn't it? Do you see it changing? Yes, we've got some new Facebook advertising going, we've got this going, we've got that going, we've implemented all this stuff, we've been testing all this everything, it's been slow up till now, we're anticipated picking up in the next 2 months. Great, well let's plan for about a month and a half time to review and work out which products are right for your new product mix. Yes, in the back there. Yes, your lady.
You're 2 to 3 years ahead of us. We're not ready for you yet.
Wow.
Great question. You know what? We do get that a couple of times when people think we're too advanced for it. So what we can do is start at a slower pace to integrate what you're doing. So that way, by the time you're ready, we can go full speed ahead with you. But you want your business to go full steam ahead, don't you? Using the latest technology, getting the best results. So I understand we seem like a big jump ahead for you right now. So let's put a scalable approach. So that way we can bring things on gradually, integrate them into what you're doing, so that way you start moving to the head of the marketplace and take advantage of all the cutting edge material we've got. But let's do it in a staged approach that works for you. Yes?
Yes.
Behind you there, the good looking one. Yes. sorry, the gooder, looking one.
Mum and dad are stubble, yeah?
I've been bombarded with too many MLM products and they're all the same.
Ooh, yeah. That's a good
Isn't that the truth? Yeah, we've all, I mean, how many of you have been bombarded by lots of networking marketing? I've been bombarded by lots of them. I totally understand. And so we were speaking to Julie, and I sat with Julie, and Julie said to me exactly the same question. And Julie said, you know what, I've seen like 9 different network marketing companies, I enrolled in 5 of them, I've got a whole boatload of stuff in the garage that I've never sold, and half my friends hate me. And I said to Julie, I apologize on behalf of all the network marketing companies who taught you the wrong way how to do network marketing.
Yep.
Here's how network marketing should work. You are surrounded by a championship team out there selling a quality product that makes a difference. Your customers fall in love with your product, can't wait for it to arrive every month, use it 100%. You're making great money with a championship team building, and you have a recipe of a company that, one, the company's not going to change its identity, the company's not going to sell out their ideals and morals, and the company is going to keep their compensation plan intact. So once you start making money, they don't go, ooh, our distributor's making too much money, we need to change it so we keep more. Mm-hmm. So the company I'm with, XYZ, is actually the company you were looking for all along. And I'm sorry other companies got in the way of you and what was possible, but having this example of me and my experience of network marketing, and if you follow the same company as me, you'll get the same results as I do or more if you work hard. That was easy. Yes.
The situation I'm in quite often is I've signed a confidentiality agreement saying I can't say how much I sold a company for, and people say, well, I can't trust you on anything unless you tell me how much you sold a company for.
So great. So I would love to share with you exactly the financial details of that transaction. I would love to right now. Except I'm bound by confidentiality, not allowed to. Now, when you and I sign a confidentiality agreement, would you like me breaking that and sharing all the details with everybody else?
Exactly.
No? Well, I won't do that with my clients as well. And because I have that confidentiality agreement in place, my clients can trust me, I work with them, and we get results. So if you want results with someone you can trust, right now, I'm going to tell you where the company you can work with. We will fight to make your company grow as hard, if not harder, than you will, to make your company succeed. Track record, experience, credentials, credibility.
Yeah, that's great.
Yes, the back there.
Yes.
The other gooder looking one.
So I've been doing a three part webinar series leading up to my online training course. And I'm following up with people and they want to go back and look at the course. I'm getting an information objection. They want to look more into it because I'm dealing with a lot of brokers who are Cs.
They want to look at all the details, you know what I mean? And so they're stalling me. Call back.
You're going to have great difficulty selling C's in what you're doing. Yeah. So you're going to find out who's your target market. Why are you selling all those C's?
I think they're C's. There are C's or D's apparently. A lot of mortgage brokers, insurance brokers.
We're just too busy.
If they're D's, you've got to sell them on results.
Yeah.
If they're C's, you've got to sell them on low risk.
Yeah, cool.
Low risk.
Yeah, I've got a guarantee, yeah.
Okay, but you reinforce the guarantee. You know what? The recordings will always be available for you.
Yeah.
But now you get more information to help support you to keep learning.
Yes.
So sell them on that, and we go into the 14 key factors of this, the 3 key steps to this, the 19 things you should avoid when doing this, and they're going to go, I want all that. So you just sell them on the value of the details they're going to miss if they don't go ahead with it. And the bigger gap you can have between what you're going to share with them and what they currently know means you're going to be more likely. The 19 key things I shouldn't do, yeah, it's 19 key things why most people lose money in this industry that our clients don't. Okay, 2 more. Yes, the back, another good back, yes.
But it's more like a situation where a company promises to pay you and they say, yeah, it's coming next week. And then next week, nothing comes in, and then you follow up and say, oh, sorry, we'll pay you next week. And then it just goes on and goes on. And say, oh,
is that from a network marketing company?
No, company.
Tristan's not paying you? Tristan.
Although I've been in that situation before.
So this is about them not paying you?
No, it's a mistake I made with a client.
It's not an objection.
Okay, so you just got to follow the payment terms. You just got to get clarity about what situation they're really in and work out, you know, when they can make consistent payments.
Oh, yeah.
That's all. Okay, one more. Yeah, come over here.
What if you're really good at what you do, you just don't have that huge track record of, you know, all the swathes of testimonials?
If you're good at what you do, it means you haven't been collecting the testimonials and all those endorsements. You need to start as fast as possible to get it. Straight away, you start banking lists of endorsements, lists of great stories, lists of material that you use going forward. You haven't got it, but start collecting it. Ask people, would you give me an endorsement? I'm really busy. How about I write up the endorsement for you? And you, if you approve it and it's okay, just send it back to me and we'll use that. That's how Clinton got Mark Peter Hansen's one. He wrote it for him, said to Mark, look, I spoke at your event, can I use this quote? Mark goes, sure, go ahead. But now we're using it for 9 years. Okay, so we're going to leave it here. What you're going to do is break into groups of 4, so you get done faster. Your presentation will be a total of 1 minute. That's it, 1 minute. And 3 minutes.